No one can start to read my book and say, you can't defeat this man. This man's a God man. Interesting.
It will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine.
For this sermon by listening. healing. Because I'm going to tell a story from the book of Esther. You may open up your Bible to the book of Esther, but I want to talk through that part in a story in the book of Esther. And it would take too much time to actually have you turn to each chapter, because I want to use the book of Esther to encourage us. It's a very interesting story. And the theme today is never give up hope. We want to look at this entire story and then take some lessons from it that will help us to never give up hope, never lose hope. It doesn't matter what is going on in your life, how things look right now, you never give up hope. So, your Bibles are open to Esther, but I'm going to ask you to indulge me and listen carefully as I relate the story to you. So, here goes. In Esther chapter 1, we have King Xerxes, otherwise called Ahasuerus, right? He is the king of Persia and Media. But then his kingdom stretches into India and other parts. At this moment, when this book was written, King Ahasuerus, or Xerxes, was the dominant king, and Persia was the dominant power. So there came a time in chapter 1, as it accounts, where the king decided to treat the entire nation of Persia. He started with his leaders first and had this posh banquet. Then after that, he invited all who could come. Can you believe it? He said, great and small, rich and poor, everybody who's anybody, to come to the 7-day banquet, the 7-day feast. And he had it in his garden, must be a big garden. And he spared no expense. Decoration, plants, you name it. And the Bible also says that he used different kinds of goblets, different kinds of glasses in terms of putting in the wine. And he said that anybody who wants to drink can drink. Those who don't want to drink don't have to drink. So there's no compelling of people. So here's what happened. Everybody was having fun, food, and some juice. Depending on what kind of juice people were drinking. King Xerxes felt so merry that he decided that he was going to call out his wife, Vashti. By the way, I should say this before I say this. Vashti was also having, she was the queen, she was king in her wife. She was also hosting a banquet, by the way, at the same time. So don't think that she was looking on the phone. She was hosting a banquet for the ladies and so forth. But then King Xerxes got married. Too married. And he sent for his wife and said, she's a beautiful woman. So he said, come and model to the people then. I want everybody to see who you are and how beautiful you look. So he wanted to show off his wife and turn her into this modeling contest person. Vashti disobeyed. Vashti said, no, I am not going to be a part of that. I am not going to do that. So she protested. The wise men of the king heard about it, saw what was happening, and then said, my word, perhaps other men in the kingdom are going to want to, other women in the kingdom are going to want to disobey their husbands. So, what if we want to do something like they disobey? Let us make an example out of Vashti. Something has to be done, O king. And so, banish her, so that we can let all of the women and all of the men see. Not my role. Because I'll tell the story. So, Vashti was banished from the Persian kingdom for not obeying the king. Fast forward to chapter 2. In chapter 2, King Xerxes starts to miss his wife. He remembers what happened and how she's not there. The wise men picked up on that and had a suggestion. They said to the king, why not try and get another wife? And it's interesting, I would call it another form of contest. Say, let us send out to the kingdom and find some virgins who will come in and have a contest in one sense to see who will become the next queen. And so they sent out that, and what was happening at that point was that they should go through 1 year of purification, 6 months of iron down, and then 6 months of perfuming up. I like that. 6 months of iron down and 6 months of perfuming up. Get it? So at this point, we're introduced to both Esther and Mordecai. Esther and Mordecai are cousins. They are cousins. But Mordecai was older than Esther. Esther was an orphan. Her parents died. So Mordecai was like her adopted, she was his adopted daughter in that regard. He took care of her. Mordecai sent Esther to be a part of this. Now, when Esther went there, those who were taking care of her realized there's something special about her. She was extremely beautiful and had a sweet personality about her. So, what happened was that she and her maidens were given the best place in the kingdom to prepare for this. When they were all prepared and ready, the maidens went out and they went to the king. But when the king's eyes beheld Esther, he said, "Man, this is the one." And indeed, she became the one, and Esther was appointed queen in place of Vashti. Alright? Please note that Esther was a Jew. She never revealed her nationality to the kingdom or the king. They didn't know. Mordecai decided to camp at the doorway of the king and visited or looked out for Esther daily. So this is where Mordecai was, camping out, staying at the king's doorway. Mordecai camps here, and then one day when Mordecai was at the king's doorway, remember he lives there now, he overheard two men plotting to kill the king. Mordecai hears this, tells Esther, Esther then tells the king. The king investigates and finds out that it is true. They were indeed trying to kill him, and he finds them and hands them. Now, this was recorded in the book of what you call Anon, the idea of chronicling deeds that were done. So the king did not reward Mordecai. He knew Esther told it was Mordecai who brought this to her attention. So the king had it recorded in the name of Mordecai doing this good deed. Fast forward to chapter 3. In chapter 3, we then have the introduction of this man called Haman. Haman was promoted in chapter 3 to a very high position. He was higher than the princes, higher than the captains, and Haman loved this particular opportunity. And he used this opportunity to have people bow down to him. Everybody bowed down to him that he passed, except for Mordecai. When the men didn't see Mordecai bowing to Haman, they said, "Why you don't bow? You don't see the big man of God." Mordecai don't regard that. That's only one person bows to God. So they took this news to Haman and said, "Here is a Jew," and the Bible definitely accounts that they didn't just say Mordecai. There's a Jew out there that does not regard you. His name is Mordecai. He's not bold. So here what Haman did. So we're going to catch him. Haman went there and sure enough, Mordecai never bowed. From that day onward, Haman bowed from his purpose that he was going to not just kill Mordecai, but every person's kingdom would him too. The Bible said that he thought it just a slight thing just to kill Mordecai. He said, "You know what? You want to kill off your whole nation." So a hatefulness, a hatred was launched by Haman upon Mordecai and the Jews. Right? So for Haman's schemes to get rid of the Jews. Here's what he did. He went to the king, and then he told the king that there are certain Jews who do not regard the laws and so forth. And he said, there's a way that we can get rid of them, because if you don't, then they're going to take step by you. So the king, he had Haman and the king sign a decree. And the decree was that all Jews were to be killed by a certain time. And it went so rapid succession. They said the fastest horsemen they could find. And so it went out that Jews were to be killed. The entire nation of Jews in Persia were to be eradicated by a certain time. Chapter 4. Mordecai and the Jews hear of this. And they are in mourning. They are sad. But they go in fasting and prayer. Esther, who is in the kingdom, hears what is going on and inquires of Mordecai what is happening and why it's so sad. In fact, the Bible says that Esther, remember where Mordecai is, you know, at the king's doorway, it was not allowed for you to be sad in the king's countenance, or for you to wear grave clothes. In other words, Mordecai put on sackcloth and ashes and would silence the king's countenance. So Esther actually sent her maid and said, she said to her husband, to put on something nice, so can I look so? Mordecai didn't put on nothing. So she said, what is wrong with you? What's going on? So he relates to her how the Jews are in jeopardy. And he then says to Esther, we need your help. He says in a way to let her know that Esther, our nation, your people are in jeopardy. And he says to her, Esther, please note this very thing, that you yourself are in jeopardy because you're a Jew. Don't think that because you're in the palace, we won't find you out, and you yourself can lose your life. So please, Esther, use your influence. Who knows that you are here for such a time as this? Esther was saying it's a dangerous thing to approach the king when it is not time to be approached. Kings are funny people. He is a very beautiful wife. If she approached him out of due time, he could be killed. So she said, man, it's a dangerous thing to do. But she said, I am going to do it, and if I perish, I perish. And so everybody, she said, pray for me, I pray for myself, and she let everybody pray. So that's chapter 4. Esther decides to risk it all to save the Jews. Chapter 5. Esther decides to approach the king. She prepared herself, adorned herself nicely, put on one of the king's favorite dresses, I suppose, nicely made up and everything. And she just wanted to think I was passing one day. So she was kind of done by herself in front of him nearby, as far as the pyramids of alone. And the king saw her and said, like sauce, like porridge. Say, Esther, tell me what you want. You give you up to half of the kingdom because why are you looking good to this? You think so bad? It's all in the Bible. We just want to listen. I'm telling a story. When Esther comes, Esther then requests a banquet or a feast with Haman, him and Haman. When Haman heard of this, Haman said, yes, this is important. Tell your wife and friend of mine, big and important, you know, the queen will request for a private banquet with just she and the king. When they both were at this banquet or feast, the king repeated himself, Esther, tell me what you want. You want to give up. At least half of the kingdom, we're ready to give it up. And then Esther, instead of telling him what she wants, says, I request a second banquet with you and Haman tomorrow. So she didn't reveal it yet. Haman left pleased like these cats. They want to be proper in the pulpit. Please, cats. It is being recorded. Alright, let somebody go say, wait, so like, we being proper. So he was pleased with himself. Pleased with himself and said, why is it so important? Because I think tomorrow come to see what is going to be. Maybe it's a new position, maybe it's being supposed to take over the kingdom. How can I stop and go to him and then? Until Haman saw Mordecai on his way out. And the Bible said it angered him. It begs his spirit to see Mordecai not going to him, and this man, this Judas, keep disregarding him. So he went home angry. His wife and friends said, watch over yourself. He was mixed with emotion, both pleased with himself and angered by Mordecai. And his wife and friends said, do some more to not think about like Mordecai. Haman had a gallows built. A gallows, of course, is something that you can't keep around. So he had a gallows built for Mordecai. Chapter 6. The king remembers Mordecai's deed and decides to honor him. He was having a sleepless night. No, we don't get to the Haman and this dinner yet. But the king, chapter 6, verse 1 begins by saying, the king could not sleep. He was having a sleepless night. And he took up the books, the chronicles are the Haman and read them since he couldn't sleep. And then he noticed this recording of Mordecai saving his life. And then he asked, what should I do to honor somebody who saved my life? And then he asked his wise men around, what should I do? And they said, oh, up to him and you ask him. So he said, Haman, come in. Haman, come in. And Haman said, yes, king. Haman, a king, Ahasuerus said, what would you do for a man who has saved, who deserves any honor? You never give him some details, I never tell him anything. He said, give me some advice, Haman. What would you do for somebody who is to be honored? Haman thought it was himself. And the Bible said, then who else is to be honored but me? Plus, remember, we have been a number two coming up. Why? Like a look of him. So Haman just said, if a me man think God, never make sure that he do everything with me with a man say down to himself. So Haman gives his advice. Haman says, you need to make sure that you put this person in the king's room, put this person on the king's heart, and put the king's crown on him and lead him on. Let somebody pour that lead him through the streets and say, hey, the man the king wants to be honored. And King Ahasuerus said, go thou and do that to Mordecai. The one whom he hates. No, picture the irony of it. The Bible seems to indicate that not only did he have to do it, it would sound like he had to dress him up, put on the robe, put on the cloak, can you imagine his face? Put him on the horse, and then it was Haman who had to lead him through the street like a boy. And the person whom the king wants to honor. Why? The Bible says Haman was disturbed. Haman went home in sadness and shame. No, his wife and friends, wise men, saw how sad he was. And said, what wrong with you? And he tell them what he had to do. Now, I want to quote this one. Not word perfect, but from a different translation. It was an interesting phrase or statement that one of the wise men said. When Haman told him that he had to honor this Mordecai whom he hates so much, whom he has built a gallows for. And I quote, what the wise men explained, Mordecai is getting the better of you. and it appeared you will not conquer him, but you will fall before he does. These were the same wise men who were helping to plan Mordecai's demise. No one of them started to read the minds up and said, you can't defeat this man. This man's a bad man. Interesting. Chapter 7. King and Haman are at Esther's second banquet. The king makes the same plea. Esther, don't keep in a suspense. Tell me what you want. We will give you anything of the half of the kingdom. So Esther relates the story that you now know, that the Jews' lives were in jeopardy. And then he says, then who will kill off the nation? Are you? She says, the man who is sitting there, thou art the man, the one here man, and him and plan everything to kill off their people. The king was furious. The king was so furious he couldn't act right there. So the king stepped outside, left Haman and Esther there, and was just fuming over what am I doing with Haman. While that was going on, Haman started catching fire. And I would suspect a few fluids may have come down his legs. I think that he would have wet his pants before wearing one. And so in his desperation, Haman attempts to beg the queen by falling to her feet and saying, don't have mercy, don't make him kill me, now beg you. But as he was begging her and falling to attend to her feet, in comes the king now. And when the king looks, it appears from the king's perspective and the king's anger that Haman was harassing or molesting his wife. Because the couches that they used to recline on were almost like a very light now laid down position. So when Haman is at her feet, by the way, in the culture at that time, it was an immodest act to be at a woman's feet like that. You would see quite the opposite, that women or men fall at a man's feet or a king's feet. But to fall at a woman's feet, you know what can be exposed. So the king is saying, what inappropriateness is this? First of all, kill all the people, the queen's people, no more than one less, and harass the wife. The king got even more furious and said, you know what? Mordecai was third, and Haman was hanged, and this yellow disappeared for another man. Chapter 7. Hey, sorry, you're following. Very good. Now, here is the issue. Haman is out of the way, but now they need to redeem themselves, the Jews. So, what started to happen? Haman is dead. Mordecai is now being promoted. He has been put in a place of prominence. And here's what happened. The Jews are now given an edict because the queen is saying, King, we need help here. What was ordered for them to be killed could not be reversed because it was done on the law of the Medes and the Persians. It was irreversible. But what they could have done was to do something else. And she said, give us the weaponry and the help we need in order to defend ourselves. So they sent out an edict that every Jew that is going to be attacked must defend themselves, fortify yourself, and they used the fastest horsemen, and they got that all around so that they were able to put themselves together. Now it was interesting that some of the people tried to attack the Jews. Chapter 9. Chapter 9 tells you that the Jews got support and strength from the king's rulers, the king's captains, and the king's army. So that when others tried to attack them, the Jews were not harmed in the process. In fact, They ended up, the Jews and those who were supporting them, ended up killing about 500 people, including the 10 sons of Haman. And they overcame their attackers. The Jews were on the verge of being annihilated. They were on the verge of being their nation being wiped out, because I want you to understand that the few Jews that were left scattered around the world were not enough to even populate the place. Most of them were in this place at Persia at this moment. So if they were all killed, that would be a threat to the nation of Israel. That's how important that story was. So it was important that they survived this. And indeed, they overcame. Listen to me very carefully now. You've heard the story. It just so happened that Vashti was banished and Esther replaced her. It just so happened that Mordecai saved the king and is later honored and promoted. It just so happened that Haman hated Mordecai and then had to honor him. It just so happened that Haman prepared a gallows for Mordecai and was then hanged on the same gallows he prepared for Mordecai. It just so happened that Jews' lives were at risk and then Esther put her own life at risk for the Jews. It just so happened that the Jews were to be eliminated, but instead were elevated. It just so happened that God's name was never mentioned in this book or this story, but it has God's name written all over it. Esther is one of those books where God's name is never mentioned, but it has God written all over it. My friend, it didn't just happen. Nothing just happened with God. In fact, God makes things happen. So the lessons from Esther, never give up hope, even when you don't see God in all of it. Never give up hope, even when people are plotting against you. Never give up hope, even when your life is in jeopardy. Never give up hope, even when you don't know what God is doing. Never give up hope, for God is at work and He remembers you. Never give up hope, for one day the tables will turn. Never give up hope, for it is not the end of your life. Never give up hope, for victory could be just around the corner. My friend, never give up hope, for your breakthrough might just happen. And watch God turn your story around and your end in a better place. Let us pray. Lord, I pray that someone here may be encouraged. If there is someone who was on the verge of giving up, I pray, dear God, that you would help them to hold on. Lord, there might be someone here that does not understand the circumstances they are in. There might be someone here who is impatient. There might be someone here who is being crushed The space is tight and they don't know what to do. Help them to never give up hope. There might be someone here who doesn't know how this will all end for them. But if they trust you, in due time you will reveal. I pray that we will learn to let you work in miracles. I pray that we will learn to allow you to be our great defender, no matter what is going on in our life. If there are persons who are waiting for their breakthrough, tell them to remember it will happen when you say so. So God, I pray that we will remember that you are the God who makes things happen. So Lord, we give over our circumstances to you. We give over ourselves to you. We give over our families to you. We give over our church to you. We give over our workplace and our friends to you. Lord, we give it all up and over to you. And I pray, dear God, that we will leave here fortified in our faith, understanding that a story like this that has God's name missing, has God's name written. To help us to see, give us spiritual eyes to see the God of providence who does what he's supposed to do. Help us to never question God again, but to just simply trust him. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.